Good evening. I'd like to call to order this July 26th regular board meeting of the Pullman School District. We will begin, as we always do, with a flag salute. Director Kinzer, would you like to lead us in the flag salute? And I apologize for not asking earlier. Okay, thank you.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Next item on our agenda is approval of tonight's agenda. Superintendent Maxwell, are there any changes to tonight's agenda?
There's been one change to note. The earlier packet that was sent out had student handbooks, and those have been removed from the agenda. So if you saw that in the previous posting, there's a difference that it's not included in this packet tonight.
Okay. With that change noted, I would be delighted to receive a motion for approval of the agenda.
I will so move.
Is there a second?
Second it.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded that we approve the agenda as amended. Any further discussion? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, tonight's agenda is approved. Next, we move on to reports, correspondence, and program, beginning with board reports. And Director Weed, I realize you just walked in, but do you have a board report? Okay. Director Johansson?
Two reports. Just want to say that if we all in the community have an opportunity next year, because WSU is applying again to host Iraqi students, I would encourage there to be a line where everybody wants to have one or more of the students for a couple of weekends. It was really a rich, enriching experience. It was a lifetime friendship struck in a short amount of time. It was very, very interesting and educational. And I wish that schools had been in session so the students could have had more contact with our student, particularly at the high school. And I'm not remembering the name, but one of the key persons in hosting via WSU was, maybe Joe will know, Pullman High School, a student who was an intern to the whole process. She's a current student, I think gonna be a senior at Pullman High School, so she was an intern. The second thing I want to report on is that some of you may know that, and I forwarded it to the board, that there was an article in the Seattle Times last Friday, I believe, that indicated, quote, in the article, that a policy of the Freedom Foundation's draft resolution on transparent bargaining had been provided, quote, to the Pullman School Board. And in the discussions, sometimes we had sides about that, presentations, people made assertions that we had gotten the policy from the Freedom Foundation and presented it and passed it here. In fact, we have, as a board, have said that that is not true. And even though I came close to getting the article retracted, or that part of it retracted, in the end, the Freedom Foundation presented a copy of the policy that had been passed by Lincoln County, and they don't, on their website, claim that that's their policy, but they do continue to state that on their website, the Freedom Foundation, that the policy that the Pullman School Board passed was provided by the Freedom Foundation. And my assertion is that provided means making contact and giving us something. And that, in fact, did not happen. That's the end of my report.
Thank you. Director Kinzer?
I have no report this evening.
I also have no report this evening. So we'll move to the superintendent's report.
Thank you. A couple of quick items tonight. Kamiak Elementary, we're still working on the grading for that and signed documents for authorization to proceed with construction, but we're still in the grading phase, so they're working nonstop now, it seems like, out there, so making some progress. I also want to note that we received a letter from the Washington State Patrol annual inspection. For the past 2 years, the results in our district have been outstanding, and just want to recognize our transportation department, and Tammy, tonight for their good work. So again, we had an outstanding report on our vehicle transportation safety. Recap on the board advance that was on July 12th. We've been working diligently on our projects and assignments from the board advance, so stay tuned. More information to follow. So, and lastly, just to let you know, we did have a bargaining session with the teachers on July 20th, and we were able to schedule another session August 18th from 9 a.m. till noon, and we already had a previous scheduled meeting in the afternoon of August 23rd. So, so we had a bargaining session with the teachers on August 18th from 9 to noon. And in addition, I believe it's 1 to 3 on the 23rd of August.
Okay.
That's my report.
Okay. That's all you did in the bargaining session was just schedule other bargaining?
I did not attend. I was handling a crisis. So,
okay.
Assistant Superintendent Roberta Kramer attended for me. So,
at least you could agree on something, huh? Okay. Are you going to introduce this presentation?
I can, if you'd like.
Okay, yeah.
And we have our guests with us, so they are going to do a brief presentation. That's a robotics club, so I'll invite them up to introduce themselves and provide us with information about their project.
Great. Thank you so much for letting us come today. My name is Helena Johnson, and I'm a mentor for the group. And I met Susan at the Governor's Summit that they had, and they talked about Career Connect Washington, an initiative that they want to better prepare students from even before high school to get their secondary degree. And our program fits really well with what the objectives are for that, and I put down there so you can see that. But so we're part of FIRST, which is for Inspiration, Recognition, and Science and Technology. It's been around for over 25 years now, and it has programs from kindergarten all the way through high school, and so we are part of the high school part. And this is Sarah.
All right, so I'm Sarah. I'm going into my senior year here at Pullman High School, and so this is my fourth year on the robotics team. I am the safety captain and then the lead electrical student also. So this club, I've been a part of it for 4 years, so I think it's amazing. And so basically it starts out, the season technically starts in January, but we're meeting all throughout the year. So the season starts in January and there's 45 days. They give us a task that the robot has to complete. And so there's a design and building process through those 45 days. And then we literally put the robot inside of a bag and close the bag, and we can't touch it again until the next competition. And so there's this 2 week period where we have 30 pounds of holdout weight, where we can kind of design some more and change some more things about it. But that's it, till our first competition. So we make it to our first competition and we unpack the robot, and inevitably we're slightly overweight, so we start drilling holes and stuff and cross our fingers and don't blow on the scale. So we eventually get a competition ready, and we compete a number of times throughout the day and make it to the finals the next day. And so the first two competitions,
we went to West Valley. So actually, we're part of a Pacific Northwest district, which is about 160 teams. We compete against big schools, little schools, private schools, all over Washington State and Oregon and Alaska. And so first we go to West Valley High School, and then our second competition is usually in Ellensburg. And every year we get better and better, we get farther and farther. We've gone to the World Championship now 4 years in a row. And Mackenzie will tell us more about the robot.
So every year it's a different game. We play things like basketball and volleyball and soccer. And this year?
So this year we were assigned a task. It was, the theme was steampunk. So everything was themed as steampunk. And so this year we were tasked to get this flying machine in there. And what you were supposed to do was to use the gears and the fuel that we called it, and you shoot the fuel into these poppers. So you could build up fuel pressure, and gears. You get gears onto this this flying machine, and you're supposed to get enough fuel pressure and fix this machine up enough to get it to be able to fly off. And you get extra points if you were able to get your robot to climb up this flying machine. So
there's always kind of an end game. So in the last 30 seconds, the robot has to grab a rope and pull itself up. And it's 120 pounds. And we had an amazing robot. So the kids start off making prototypes. And so we ran down to the dollar store and got those, and they played with Velcro, so it would be like fingers that could grab onto the rope.
I think we went through 3 iterations on the climber, and it's actually a problem that was team after team after team saw that whole solution and just smacked their heads. Because what would happen is that as a robot would climb, it would get off kilter a little bit, and that rope would start going over, and it never failed. The last 2 inches, the rope hits the side support that they're climbing. And they would jam the robots. So, I mean, literally, there were robots that stopped. And $2 for a bowl fixed it.
And our climber was one of the best out there. It worked every single time if we were able to get there in time to climb. It took about 8 seconds, and it climbs about this high off the ground. So we were pretty proud of that.
Yeah, this is a very unique program because we've got about 30 students. About 25 of them, about 95% are from Pullman High School, and then the other few are from outside, like Colfax and Colton, and a couple from Moscow. But there's usually always about 15 mentors, and they're from WSU and SEL and other businesses around the community. So we're really excited to be able to collaborate with the school district and have this kind of program.
Do you,
Jones,
do you have anything?
As a parent of
the... I'll say something. My daughter's Sarah, and, you know, Sarah's a good student. She makes good grades, and she doesn't, sports are not her thing. She doesn't play sports. And so when she was a freshman, she said she wanted to do robotics club. I didn't even want to take her to the meeting. I was like, oh, I don't know about this. But let me tell you, it's a really cool place. I mean, she's found a place where she sort of can belong, but then also, I mean, she sort of studies some electrical theory and then some practical sort of electrical work along with like CAD design and computer programming, stuff that she wouldn't be exposed to otherwise. And I remember as an eighth grader, she was contemplating possibly being a teacher. That was one thing smart, which I'd be really proud if she was. That'd be a great career. But since robotics, she's just, it sort of kind of opened up her vision, and she's sort of waffling between engineering and medicine. And so I think that's just because of this. I mean, I think she was exposed to something. And part of this they didn't mention is even if kids aren't mechanical or whatever, there's a whole business side where they have to develop a business model. There's a whole scouting side where they have to scout other teams. They have to be interviewed by adults that learn interviewing skills. So it's been really cool. I mean, I'm mostly the chauffeur and sit in the stands and cheer. But it is a really cool program. It's really beneficial.
If we have a few seconds, can we show you the recap?
Sure.
Thank you.
Just depends on how long
to cut these corners, try to take the easy way. I kept on falling short of something. I could have gave up then, but then again I couldn't have, cause I've traveled all this way for something. I take it in, but don't look down,
cause I'm on top of the world.
Same kind of basic
You have to completely build the whole thing from scratch every year?
Yes. It's completely different each year, down to the size of the robot. There was one several years back where they were stacking totes on top of each other.
That was my freshman year. So that robot was very different. It was about this tall, about the same like base, but it was about this tall and had two arms that stuck out the front with spinning discs. It was a completely different game, like not even the same ballpark.
But they're usually about 120 pounds that you have to work with.
That's the yoga ball bot, giant yoga ball. This is my first year mentoring.
Do all 30 students travel to?
No, not okay. Always. There's always, you know, school conflicts, you know, testing or, but they usually, it usually coordinates with spring break, 1 week, and another week was like a midwinter break at the beginning of March, and so there's usually about, well, going to the World Championship, there's usually about half the kids that can go. Mm-hmm.
And I know
to the World Championship every year, and it's a great experience. It's been great.
I noticed the club doing a lot of service activities. Is that an expectation if you're on the team that you have to do?
Yes, we will.
Yes.
Well, depending on how our schedules are, but there's always opportunities out there, and one of our main goals is to, to change the culture to. It started because they saw that students admired rock stars and sports figures, and so they wanted to make the science and make this project that they do as exciting and fast paced and as any of those kind of events. Mm-hmm. So, but you guys are all welcome to come to watch us up at West Valley or. A lot of times we get at Cheney at Eastern Washington University, and it just we're so glad that we meet at Lincoln Middle School. You probably recognize that, and we're really grateful to be able to do that. We are looking for a forever home, so if you guys have a corner for us.
How is the group supported?
A lot of our biggest supporter is Schweitzer Engineering,
good.
And then we go to other. Other groups around the community, or
So we've gone up to Digilent and Decagon, and we go on sponsorship runs where we bring a small group of people. Usually Helena, because she's our head business mentor, and we'll go to small businesses around town and just anywhere, and like, hey, do you have room to sponsor us this year? And so we take this board actually, and little packets. And so we give little presentations about, you know, what our year is like. And so this is this year's board, and we have, you know, what our team is about and how the season looks and kind of off-season stuff and newspaper clippings, things like that, to try and get interest.
And online there's lots of grants like that. We got a Google grant, one from Inland Power and Light.
Oh, nice.
They helped us buy our trailer because we were using a horse trailer for many years. And we've got our own now, so we're excited.
It's very
that.
Nice. I've seen it in the Dismore's parking lot.
Yes.
I've been coming freshman trying to find out how to get involved with it.
Oh, well, we try to have flyers or let people know about the camps. We're going to do the Lecce Festival.
Okay.
And so then the kids can, we usually connect with a lot of kids then.
Doing the presentation this spring or fall, excuse me?
I hope so, hopefully. We wanted to see if we could work with, I think it's Sherry Comp, who's one of the teachers here, and see if maybe we can get, see if she'd like to participate or have the kids come and, I think she's doing engineering, like Latin, some engineering kind of focus on her class. Okay.
We can look into it.
And FIRST also has over $15 million worth of scholarships.
Wow.
And as a mom, I've had both kids in the program, and my oldest son is now going to be a senior here at WSU for mechanical engineering, and he's gotten the scholarships every year. So it's been very good for our family, too. Any other questions?
Well, I just might make a comment that, again, this year, robotics is proposed And FIRST is the preferred proposal to be a WIA-sponsored activity. And what's important about that, if it eventually is approved, is that it would count in the Scholastic Cup, which is a combination of grades and also performance in athletics and activities, not just sports, but also the activities like forensics and orchestra and voice and so on. It's getting closer. The first big battle was whether it was going to be Lego or FIRST as a competition. I'm lucky enough to be in a position where I can at least talk about it when it's proposed and have some influence. And I've used this as a model for the community cooperation and the number of schools involved. Mm-hmm. And I'm hoping that if it is finally approved, that that model will be allowable for a combine. Those are allowed in other sports. Like, for instance, we've had tennis players from Palouse and so on, swimmers from Colfax over the years. And the tricky part would be having somebody from, at least in previous years, there were students involved from Moscow. And so how all that works out, the first step is getting it accepted. And then I think it's important for STEM-like activities to be involved in Scholastic Cup. Right now, they're not. So,
anyway. Well, if there's anything we can do to help, we'd be there for you.
I'll certainly call upon you the next time the amendment process starts.
Okay. Well, we won't take any more time. I think we've taken a lot.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Very much. Awesome.
I want to see that baby climb.
Yeah.
We actually have a wooden framework for taking out and demonstrating the climb.
Maybe
you didn't bring that in?
Yeah. Height restriction.
It's 120
pounds plus, so that's another 15. And it gets
fast. Well, fast,
yeah, if he cranks it.
Wow.
You've moved that
thing
a few times then, huh?
Modified paper. That's what they are.
Yeah, the kids actually have carried on and off the field. So they can't leave the cart, so that's why we created the handles this year.
Smart. Yeah.
On and off the field. Mm-hmm. Good terminal. Yes.
Do you want to make any information about joining or the...
Oh, yes, please.
Or the camp? Oh, another thing we forgot to mention, but I think is really cool, is that so the year before my freshman year, there was one girl in robotics.
Yeah.
And so now we've got maybe half girls, so that's really exciting.
Yeah, all right, definitely.
And they take leadership roles.
Our main driver this year was Elizabeth, senior?
Yeah, she's a senior. She's going to be the UW in Germany.
Absolutely amazing driver.
I would like thank you, and
okay.
Yes, please.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Two here. There we go. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you again.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming.
The next part of our agenda is the visitors section. This part of the agenda is for anyone wishing to speak before the board, either as an individual or a member of a group. Visitors addressing the board will go to the microphone and state their name and address prior to presenting their information. The board will listen and may offer clarification, but will not discuss the topic at this time. The board may consider moving the topic presented to a future meeting date as a discussion item. Please keep your comments civil and respectful and limit your remarks to 3 minutes. We do have a sign-in sheet, so I'm going to take the speakers, well, you're already there, so I'll just, and then this, I don't know if everyone is familiar with our timer. It's a visual timer, so it starts out, it's in the green, and then when 85% of the time is expired, it moves into the yellow, and then the final 5% is the red. So go ahead.
My name is Janice Brown. I'm a retired member in the community, and I've lived here for about 10 years, and I have no, I'm originally from Oregon, so I don't know.
And your address, Janice?
1430 Northwest Dean, Apartment 2. I only talk on one topic, and this is my fourth time before the board, and the board has just listened but not taken any action. I want the board to fund the Pullman School Resource Officer's position. And the school resource officer, I do support it staying as a police officer because resource officers need police training as well as the unique school training. And as you grow to another, we almost need two now. And when the funding, many school districts hire their own school resource officer, and I have learned that Spokane has spent over $1 million hiring their own. I don't think that's a good policy for Pullman. We're too small, but we need a joint funding. We need you to share the salary, the benefits, the car, not just the equipment. And the ACLU, which is, I hope you know, it's the lawyer group, gave the Spokane School District's police policy a good mark. Although in the newspaper article that I read, the school district said they gave us a good mark, but we still haven't refined our policy to meet some of the new school education laws. So they recognize they still have some work. I do believe that the district, if they will, since the ACLU said it was a good policy and you don't want them coming and suing you, I'd start there. I'd like for you to go and take that policy and with the Pullman Police Department, see how you can rewrite it to fit a model where your police officers are a city police officer serving as a school resource officer. And as when you go to your school board, you have a school board state business. So ask your other school boards, how are they, what funding source are they hiring their school officers, and seeing if you can use that same funding source or with the new enrichment, use money for that. Thank you.
Good timing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Next, Betsy Wilson.
Hi, I'm Betsy Wilson, 910 Northwest Clifford Street in Pullman. Hello again. I just am back because of last meeting I had asked the question about the administrative leave for Michael Church and when that would be dismissed. And as far as I know, that hasn't happened yet, nor have I heard any particular answer to my question. So I'm back to say I still have that same question, and I appreciate hearing an answer when as soon as possible. Thank you.
Do a clarification.
Able to.
Okay. Yeah, I'll be happy to give an update and a clarification. So the investigation is still ongoing, and I have requested at least a preliminary report, if not a final report. And so I'm waiting on that still.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I cannot remember how to reset. All right. With my apologies to the next person, who is Rhonda. I'm so sorry, Rhonda. I'm going to be fidgeting with this a little bit, but
I have a stopwatch.
All right. Prepared.
I can use the timer on my computer.
If
you enjoy timing yourself in this manner,
it's not about enjoyment. It's about trying to stick to the rules. Okay, so I didn't make copies for everybody, and I prepared a statement. I only have one. I don't know how interested you are in it. Anyway, I'm not going to read the whole thing because that takes 4 minutes even when you speak.
Thank you.
Trying to do my best.
Yeah.
And hold on, don't get me started. Deep breath. And go. I'm Rhonda Skaggs. I live at 1325 Northwest Douglas Drive. I have two kids in the Pullman School District. I would like to take this opportunity to respond to the request for feedback asked for by the music staff of the Pullman School District regarding moving elementary orchestra instruction to a before or after school program. Our award-winning orchestra teacher, Mrs. Coville, asked parents to respond to four questions regarding this topic. Basically, you know, did I find my child's participation in this program beneficial? Yes, absolutely. Specifically, I would say as introverts and reluctant participants in mainstream education, my kids, orchestra provided an activity that they looked forward to and gave them a sense of belonging to a group. In short, it helped get them to school. If elementary had orchestra had been a before or after school program, would that have changed my students' ability to participate? No. Our family could compel our children to participate, and we have flexible enough schedules to allow for it. Not everyone is in that position, however, and able does not mean willing. Kids are worn out by the end of the school day and benefit from having some downtime at home, especially when they participate in other after-school activities such as sports and private music lessons. I think in the case of our own children, they might not have willingly participated in the orchestra program during elementary school if it had not been during regular school hours. Incidentally, if students don't have orchestra experience before entering middle school, they can't participate at all. They miss the opportunity to be involved in orchestra for the duration of their school years. Not so great. I would like to point out that it would be a hardship for some families to arrange for the extra transportation needed for their children to participate in this activity. If the program was taken out of the regular school day, could the district provide families with transportation if that was needed? I wonder. And then, do I have any other comments? Yes, of course. It is my opinion that the district should do whatever it can to make this program accessible to as many students as possible and should be careful not to make it difficult for any student to participate. I'm skeptical that missing 15 to 20 minutes of classroom instruction once or twice a week, however that works out, has a negative impact on student test performance. I would like to know if there's any evidence that directly links low test scores of specific students to their participation in the elementary orchestra program during school. In absence of compelling evidence, I would urge the administration to listen to the recommendation of our experienced music staff. In closing, I will tell you what my daughter said to me the other day. She said, "I am really looking forward to getting back into orchestra." Wow. My daughter, she's an excellent student, but she doesn't love school. Special needs come in all shapes and sizes, and my advice is do whatever you can to engage kids at school. The robotics club, right? What that man said about his daughter, exactly. Whatever it takes to reach each child. And if school's enjoyable, the test scores will only be positively affected, and I'm 303. Okay, thanks. Okay.
Thank you for timing yourself. Superintendent Maxwell, would you like to offer any clarification about...
I think there may be another one with orchestra, and then I could give a clarification after that.
Oh, okay. So, Carolyn Kress, are you on orchestra or something else?
No, I'm from the Lions
Club. Okay.
Oh, sorry. I thought it was another orchestra comment. So. Rhonda in the audience, I can give an update. So, one of the things, we've had two meetings this summer already with the elementary principals and with the music staff as well, and we've been working diligently to see if we can incorporate orchestra within the school day. That's our goal. Currently, the draft schedule, we have advanced orchestra built into the schedule. We have one of the two beginning orchestras built into the school day. One currently would be before school. One of the issues we're running into is that our school spaces are so tight that there is no practice space available during the day to put in a third practice time for orchestra. So right now, that's what we're looking at. We are exploring options of possibly, you know, if there's transportation was a barrier. We did run a pilot with Franklin Elementary last year with an AM beginning orchestra, and that was very well attended and worked. So we have incorporated the orchestra teachers are working with us on that plan, but currently that's what we have scheduled. The only space available if we were to incorporate beginning orchestra a second time in the day would be the hallway. We have no, or a library space.
And the teachers weren't thrilled about that.
No.
Yeah.
The orchestra teachers in particular were not thrilled with that, nor does it make sense to do that. So,
like a multi-purpose room.
That's full. That's full. PE spaces are full. So we've had all three schedules out, and so at least temporarily until we can maybe get Kamiak, hopefully that will open, but every one of our large spaces is currently used during the day. So right now it looks like that's what the schedule would be, but our preference would definitely be to incorporate it during the day. However, space limitations and the number of students that we have participating really limit our ability to offer two beginning bands plus advanced incorporated into the day. But at least both would be at least once in the day, so.
Okay.
Excuse you. Then on this question then, if the elementary kids were not in orchestra, cannot take part in junior high and high school orchestra, because of this?
Advanced orchestra is in the day, is only during the school day.
They would still have an opportunity.
They still would have an opportunity.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Nobody.
It's only beginning. One session of beginning would be outside of the school day. Currently.
And that wouldn't limit if someone, I guess I don't fully understand all of this, but if somebody couldn't participate in both sessions of beginning orchestra, does that mean that they're going to be excluded from doing advanced orchestra, or if they have one of those sessions, are they going to be allowed to go in?
If they only attended one, if they're only able to attend the in-school, they're still eligible. So
this is a fantastic program.
We understand.
We understand, and we're trying our best, but we've already eliminated computer labs. Art room is being shared. So space is really at a premium right now. So we see this as a bridge. It's not our intention to make that permanent, but we have to do something where we're providing an adequate, correct space for the activity.
Okay.
So I hope that was helpful.
Would anyone else like to address the board at this time?
I would.
Sure. My name's Scott Wilson, and my address is 910 Northwest Clifford. And my question for the board and for the superintendent is, what is the timeline for concluding the investigation into Michael Church? School starting pretty soon. Families would like to know who their fifth grade teacher is going to be. Fifth grade teachers at Jefferson would like to start their collaboration. Mr. Church would like to know if he's coming back. So, not a lot of time left, so what would be the timeline?
Unfortunately, investigations don't have a timeline, so it's hard for me to give an answer.
And it's not the school district that's doing the investigation. It's an outside entity, so that we really don't have much control over it at all, other than we wanted someone who has no interest to be doing the investigation, and we have no control over when they can complete it.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Okay, would anyone else like to address the board at this time? Okay. Seeing no takers, we will move on to the consent agenda. To expedite business at a board meeting, the board approves the use of a consent agenda, which includes items considered to be routine in nature. Any item which appears on the consent agenda may be removed from the consent agenda by a member of the board and voted on separately. The remaining items will be voted on by a single motion. Tonight's consent agenda consists of minutes, a budget status report, warrants, transfer requests, personnel report, records destruction, and professional or personal services contracts. I would entertain a motion regarding the consent agenda.
Move approval as presented.
Okay.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve the consent agenda as presented this evening. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The consent agenda is approved. Next, we have three action items this evening. Our first action item is wellness committee goals. And our presenter tonight is our director of operations, Joe Thornton.
I'm here tonight on Sheba's behalf. And at the last board meeting, she presented updated goals for the wellness committee, included the idea of improving quality of food, trying to do as much home-cooked, home-grown food as possible. Second goal was to establish food pantries, and the third one was to continue to support walking and biking to schools. That is coming to you tonight to approve the...
Sorry, Joe.
That's okay. The wellness policy, the updated wellness policy goals. Any questions?
Are there any questions concerning the proposed wellness goals? These would be sort of broad goals that would be in effect for a few years, probably.
I will move that we approve the goals as presented.
Okay.
Seconded.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve the goals as presented. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? No one is opposed. The wellness goals are approved. Thank you, Joe. Next, we have our Assistant Superintendent Roberta Kramer on our second action item, materials adoption, novels for 11th grade English.
There we go.
As you remember, when I was here in June, I shared with you two novels that have been through the entire process. And I bring those before you tonight to ask for your approval on the things that they carried by Tim O'Brien and The Absolute True Diary of a Part-Time Indian by Sherman Alexie. Any questions?
All right. There are no questions. I would entertain a motion.
I will move that we approve the two books that you referred to this evening.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve the adoption of The Things They Carried and The Absolute True Diary of a Part-Time Indian for 11th grade English. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Also approved. And bringing Joe back up again, school meals prices for 2017-2018.
One of the wellness goals is to make sure I have to get up and walk across the room.
Yeah, you're good for
you. At the last meeting, Sheba presented some price increases for the school meals. This is a requirement based on the Section 504 of the Healthy, Hungry-Free Kids Act of 2010, and is to make sure that we are staying within a certain range of the free meal allowance provided by the federal government. The increases requested range anywhere from 0 to 25 cents for a student meal at the high school. Questions?
No, I will move that the board approve the 2017-18 meal prices as presented.
I'll second.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded that we approve the meal price schedule shown here. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? No one is opposed. Okay, thank you.
I would like in the fall for there to be an analysis of what of the previous executive order around dietary restrictions and the whole school lunch be what is still remaining of that based on the executive order that rolled back some of the requirements. I'm not sure that the pricing was part of that.
Right, no, it was not. But you're right, there have been changes in the Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act. So that might be something, Joe, that could the Wellness Committee actually yeah. go over that? And because, Joe, are you going to be chairing the Wellness? Okay, yeah.
Great. So,
he is now.
Yeah.
I just, out of interest.
Congratulations, Joe.
Wonder what we're going to be doing in the new yes. version of the act.
Yeah, I think it would be good for all of us to reflect on whatever the changes are. So thank you for that suggestion.
Okay.
Okay. Next, we are moving into really what everyone knows is the highlight of this meeting tonight.
And the most fun.
Yes.
Yes. We have our fiscal manager, Diane Hodge, here to present our 2017-2018 budget.
Well, I'd like to scare Susan and tell her I'm going to go through this page by
page.
Oh,
perfect.
But
that's what I love.
Not going to.
Okay.
Thanks. So this is just a summary. There is a detailed copy in the board packet of that kind of summarizes, easily
I'm sure
summarizes
the audience wants
our
all the information.
Our budget for the 2017 year. We do have copies of our F-195 available in the fiscal office for anyone that's interested. The recommended budgets we're bringing before the board are these five funds: our general fund, ASB fund, debt service, capital projects, and transportation vehicle fund. This just summarizes our revenues, expenditures, our beginning fund balance, and our ending fund balance. Our revenues for 2017-18, we're anticipating about $30.8 million, ASB $588,000, debt service $6 million, capital project $7.5 million, and transportation vehicle fund about $89,000. Based upon our expenditures and our beginning fund balance, we're looking at an ending fund balance in 2017-18 of about $3.9 million for our general fund, $270,000 ASB, debt service $2.4 million, capital projects $762,000, and our transportation vehicle fund $298,000. We have a board policy that we have a 6% ending fund balance. Personally, I would like it to be a 7% because that's 1 month's payroll. I think we should always have a 1 month payroll on hand. And the additional 6.78% ending fund balance, Bob and I did a pretty good analysis of what it's going to cost to open Kamiak Elementary, and it's going to take that full 6.78% for the additional staff, just everything included in a new building. Our enrollment,
I've got a question there.
Sure.
In talking about the fund balance being a percentage and with the anticipated increases in students, mm-hmm. will that figure by percentage go up accordingly so that you would still be more comfortable with 7% of the larger amount? I'm not sure that I'm asking
yeah,
the question.
You know, our enrollment's going up, but also our staff is going up, which means our expenses are going up, cost of living's going up.
Absolutely.
So, of course, our payroll is going to be going up. And so Bob and I worked out a calculation, and currently 1 month payroll is about 7%, just right at 7%. So that's our comfort zone. But, you know, board policy is 6%, which 6% is still good.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. The board approved 2,770 FTE to budget for student enrollment next year. And here's past history of student enrollment, the actual versus our estimate. As you can see, in 2016-17, we ended with 2,780 FTE. We're budgeting 2,770. We like to be a little bit conservative. We'd rather, you know, get a little bit more money in than go backwards. And that's typical. That's what we typically do. You'll see the 148 additional students that we had in 2016-17. The majority of that was full-day kindergarten, going from half-day to full-day. Our actual average versus budgeted enrollment, you can see that In 2013-14, we had an increase from the previous year, 51, then we went to 126, 162. So those 2 years, we had a huge jump in enrollment. And then 16-17, we're starting to level off a little bit with just 40. Our staff FTE summary, again, you can see we're increasing staff. In 2017-18, we're actually adding 11 additional new position certificated staff. And then classified employees is pretty much staying even. We did hire a couple more teachers instead of parapros this year, or for next year is our anticipation. Our funded versus budgeted, our funded for 17-18 is the state is going to fund us at 164.63 certs. We're budgeting 178.9, which leaves us a difference of 14 that we'll be picking up out of our M&O levy to pay for that. Classified staff, 48. We have 90, pretty much 97, and which leaves our M&O picking up 48 of those classified staff. So that's what it's costing us for those 14 teachers, the 48 classified staff, the benefits included in those. So our M&O is picking up about $3.6 million for our additional staff. Our general fund budget this year is going to be $30.8 million based upon 2,770 students. We have 186 certificated staff, that's headcount, not FTE, and 143 classified staff. And we are going to be about $2.2 million over in expenditures versus what we were in 16-17. This is a breakdown of where our money is coming from. This is our local M&O levy. This is just local support non-tax that we get in, food service, et cetera. And the majority, again, is coming in our state, which is our apportionment based upon our FTE, based upon down here, I've got enrollment continues to increase a little bit. Salary and benefits, we got a 2.3% cost of living. We're getting fully funded for K-3 class size this year. It won't happen next year, but they're giving it to us this year. Per pupil allocation for our MSOCs went up $20.80, and our retirement contributions are increasing 2%. I put that in there because the state has to give us partial funding for that. So
Diane, the special class size reduction mm-hmm. fund will be folded into the new funding formula?
In 18-19, they're gonna hold us accountable for it. So they're gonna look at our class sizes proportionately and fund us for that. So this year they're not even looking at class size; they're just gonna fund it for us. Next year it goes back to accountability. So where does the money come from? Again, the majority of it comes from the state. And then the state's special purposes is your LAP, HICAP, ESL, revenue from other school districts, it's less than 1%. Local taxes, our M&O levy is our second highest. And then revenue from other entities is just less than 1%. And again, here's the percentages. And just a breakdown of what our general expenditures by program. Our basic education, it takes up about $17 million. Special education, almost $3.2 million. VOC has increased quite a bit this year, $1.3 million. Compensatory education, which is your LAP, ESL, and then your HICAP, and support services, which is your district-wide support. And then here's just a list of what your direct classroom support entails, your indirect classroom support, and your district level support. Again, your district level support is going to be your district wide employees. There's an MSOC disclosure that we just have to state that yes, all of the money we get for MSOCs, material supplies, and operating costs actually goes to material supplies and operating costs. So, we're going to get $3.2 million in MSOCs, $138,000 just for 9 through 12 grades. That's additional money on top of that. This is kind of a breakdown of where that money is going. This is basic ed, and this is district-wide support. Our total budget for MSOCs is about $4,654,000, which means 1.3 million of that is picked up by our M&O. Again, where's the money spent? Employee benefits, certified salaries take up the majority of it. And then our employee benefits, classified salaries, our MSOX, and it just goes down from there. Again, their percentages, 40% are certified salaries, employee benefits, 24%, classified, 15%. Our property tax collection is the $5.3 million of our maintenance and operations levy. We anticipate 99% collection. We don't go for the full 100% because sometimes we don't get it. So this is the collection that we'll receive, anticipate, in fall of 2017 and our anticipated spring of 2018. Our capital projects fund, we are anticipating expenditures of $29.7 million. Again, this would be on the new Kamiak Elementary. $3.5 million on sites. $25 million on buildings and then equipment to go with the new building, et cetera. Again, $26 million for the new elementary, purchase property for future needs. Possibly this is just, we just budgeted money in there for anticipation in case we need it, at $3.5 million. We just wanna make sure we have the capacity in there. Our debt service fund, you know, our revenue coming in from our debt service from our bonds. This is basically what this is, and our expenditures for our three bonds. We did pay off our $1.4 million Jefferson expansion, which is saving us $300,000 over the life of the loan, so that was great. Our ASB student body fund, you know, our revenues, our expenditures. Just so you know, Lincoln Middle School and the high school, the students and the administrators there, they create their own budgets, they give it to us, and then we input it. So this is basically middle school and high school budgets. And our transportation vehicle fund, we're anticipating revenues. We have our bus depreciation of about $88,000, and then our local non-tax support is just interest. Or interest earnings that we earn on that money. We don't anticipate buying a bus. We bought a bus the last two school years. Our cycle usually is every other year, and so we don't anticipate buying one next year since we already just bought two in the last 2 years. And that is it. Any questions? Yes. He loves my presentations when I do something better than he can do, I think.
Just putting the pressure on for my next PowerPoint. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. You can have Courtney do it. Any questions?
So the one thing I got out of it was that maybe we should change our reserves to the 7% or to a... come up with a figure or a formula that it would be 1 month's payroll?
Well, I'll tell you, you know, with this last legislation, and it continues to be like this, it's been like this, I think, for the past 4 years, they're not making that deadline until the 11th hour.
Yeah.
And so what's happening is we're getting threatened that we won't get funding until they come up mm-hmm. with a budget. So there's a lot of school districts who are scrambling to borrow money to make their payroll. And so that's why we think that it's important to have that one sure. month worth of payroll and reserves, because it's just getting tighter and tighter.
Given how they process things.
And so it's just, I'm just like to be more safe than sorry to make sure we have that money in there. And opening a new school, you know, we know our expenditures are gonna drop significantly once that school opens. So I just feel comfortable with a 7% fund balance.
Okay. Well, I didn't know if we should maybe think about formalizing that or just, I mean, I'm fine with you just keeping it that way, but if we make it a formal thing for every year, it makes sense to me to always have 1 month's payroll there. At least nothing else we can pay people. Mm-hmm. Our people are
working. Well, without having to take out a loan, but right. Bob.
Yeah, I think it's something to consider given the history of the legislative sessions the last 3 years in a
yeah.
row. I mean, many of our colleague districts were literally going to have to take a loan in order to do
right.
payroll in July, which now it's costing the districts money when you have to take a loan. So to me, that's not being financially prudent. So it's something to consider.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else?
Works for me. No, thank you.
That was a very good presentation.
We might consider as part of that when we're doing it that we make it contingent on, like we have the where we have to have a plan in our capital projects budget when it gets below a certain amount.
I see what you're saying.
And we can go below that, but we need a plan for when we're going to get it back. In this case, it would be by July or whatever. Mm-hmm. So as we're tracking it through, we might need to make some reductions in expenditures in the spring mm-hmm. in order to have that so that we have, by the time we need it, the 7%. Mm-hmm.
And we have our finance committee, so that would be some really valuable stuff to discuss during our finance committee, too.
Yeah, I agree. That should go through that committee first. Yeah.
Good question.
Thank you, Diane.
Perfect.
Thank you. Okay. Joe, are you ready? Because
are you ready?
You have yes, the next four items.
Wow, this is Joe's night, huh?
Starting with the prime vendor contract renewal. Right.
I think Roberta's question to me earlier today was, why does she even have to be here if I'm going to be?
No, Roberta will have her.
She'll have her moment.
Right.
So the and again, I'm here to represent Sheba.
Did I just do something?
Yeah, that's all right.
You ruined it.
And I'm moving on while this chaos goes on around me, just like graduation.
Sure.
And the prime vendor contract that Sheba is requesting be renewed again is an interlocal agreement we have with the Spokane School District that allows us to get their pricing with Food Service of America. So it's the power. I'm fine.
Oh, okay.
I'm good. It's the power of that bigger purchase that allows us to get those better prices. If we were out as honestly a relatively small district trying to do it, we would get the same prices. So Sheba's making the request that for the 17-18 school year, we approve the contract with the interlocal agreement with Spokane Schools to allow us to have a group pricing with FSA.
So it's a continuation of...
Correct, but it needs to be approved every year. So.
Okay.
Is this issue time sensitive where we might...
This is not time sensitive as long as we have it in place by the start of school year. So the first meeting in August would be fine.
Perfect. Okay. Awesome.
All right. Anyone have any
questions? It served us well.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes.
Yep.
Okay. Excellent. Moving along then to 2017-18 clubs and fundraisers.
As an annual requirement, we are to bring to the board an outline of the clubs and fundraisers that are planned for the year. Keep in mind that this is just that. It is just a plan. Things will change. But any group that wants to add a fundraiser to this will have to bring that to the board for approval. I think the good news is when I first started working at the Pullman School District some 20-some plus years ago, there were a lot more fundraisers going on. There were a lot of T-shirt sales and this sale and that, and I think we've really backed off of that. And I think a big part of that is the support that a lot of our groups get from boosters organizations. Mm-hmm. And I also think that a lot of groups have figured out that a lot of people would just rather donate money than to buy the cookie dough, which I'm going to end up eating before it even makes it to the oven. So I just assume give them the money. So.
Well, a lot of the fundraisers, what I like, are actually an activity mm-hmm. for students to come enjoy, so they get the whole educational aspect of having a fundraiser that's also a service for the whole community. Like it's the circle of...
Yep, absolutely. Yep. It's a great learning opportunity for the importance of community service for those kids. And again, this is not time sensitive. This can be approved at the next board meeting.
Okay. Any questions about the clubs and fundraisers? Hearing none, let's go on to the dairy bid.
Again, this is something that needs to be renewed every year. The award was given to Dairy Gold in for the 15-16 school year. However, Meadow Gold. We are allowed to roll that over for 3 years consecutively if they have been a good vendor and they have been outstanding. So Sheba is requesting that we do another year's worth of work with Meadow Gold.
That'll take us till the end of the potential.
We would have, the first year was 15-16, so we can roll it over for 3 years. So this would be the second year of our three-year rollover.
Okay.
Assuming things continue to go well.
Okay. Is this, are they, I forgot, are they out of Lewiston or are they out of Spokane?
I think they're out of Spokane.
The one out of Lewiston was the one that part of the milk was coming from. Boise, remember?
Yeah.
We shifted.
Okay.
Okay. Any other questions about the dairy bid? Okay. Then on to the transportation and maintenance fuel bid.
Another exciting topic. We do this every 3 years. The good news is, Diane, is the cost of fuel has gone down significantly from what the bids were 3 years ago. Keep in mind, this is one of those prices that fluctuates. They give us a base price. Basically, what we're looking for from vendors is what margin are they going to be collecting? Because the amount that they charge us is based on a price set out of Spokane, out of the fuel depot in Spokane, something called set by Oil Price Information Service, OPIS. This year, we only had one bid offered from Bush Distributors. Don't know why. Reached out to the other company several times and nudged them for the bid. It never arrived. Shannon got tired of me asking, did that other bid show up? And the margin that they're asking for is lower than what they asked for 3 years ago. So it's all good. Now, will oil fuel prices stay this low for the next 3 years? Absolutely not.
Yeah.
And this is not time sensitive. This can wait till the next meeting as well. Any questions about the fuel bid?
Apparently not. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Joe.
It's a great bid.
All right. Next, we have Assistant Superintendent Roberta Kramer with the assessment plan.
On an annual basis, we're required to bring the assessment plan to you for your approval. There are no significant changes in the assessment plan from previous years, though a point of interest is that related to the Smarter Balanced Assessments is that we're looking at incorporating interim assessments into a regular as a way to better gauge how our students are performing. So we're looking at that. We have several teachers that have served on a committee with some central office staff. And so we're going to move ahead with that, but we're not going to establish timelines around that because we want to do it well and we want teachers to feel good about that work. Another piece that is just a little bit different is that with our MAP testing measurements of academic progress, we are tightening that window significantly. In the past, we probably left it open for about 4 weeks. We're going to leave it open for two. As we shared with you at the work session, we really need to know how our kids are performing, and we need to know earlier. And so in talking with principals, given the number of Chrome carts and things that we have, they completely believe that we could get this data gathered right away. So that's what we're attempting to do, is to tighten up some timelines. And then another piece that is different is that the end of course assessments in mathematics are gone. Students in the 10th and 11th grades next year will take Smarter Balanced. So there'll be 1 year, our seniors next year will be able to access end of course. And then collection of evidence is completely gone based on legislative action.
Just absorbing end of course exams. So there will be no more end of course exams in anything.
No.
Okay.
We'll do that in math next year.
And then, yeah.
Just parenthetically, I think I asked, did we have any students not graduate that then were grandfathered in this year? based on the
biology
of removal of the biology requirement.
I believe it was 3 students.
Good.
But they may have passed because they took them, but then they...
And they submitted a collection of evidence.
They submitted a collection of evidence. Yeah. So those 3 would have... So they passed. But we had 3 students.
It wasn't then key because their collection of evidence was accepted?
It was in process, but during the process of evaluating, they changed the law, so they never finished.
It didn't get evaluated.
Yeah, so they suspended the scoring of the collection of evidence, even though it had been submitted by the students and their teachers.
That's a shame we didn't get a litmus or a reading on what the appropriate, because it has to be accepted by the state too, right?
Right.
Right.
What?
So, I'm sorry.
No, go.
Well, I just was in the math when you no longer use the collection of evidence.
We don't use a collection of evidence in mathematics anymore at all. And of course,
you have this test.
Yeah.
You have to pass this test.
And that's why we're giving the test now in 10th grade. And so it's going to be an ongoing conversation that we have as we're moving forward because.
Yes.
Is concerning our, and one of the things that we noticed of our 10th graders that took the Smarter Balance Assessment in Mathematics this last year, if kids had been in statistics, they took the assessment and they tended to do better. We had some students that didn't meet the standard, but most did. And so I think for us, that's telling that we know that they need that experience. However, the Smarter Balanced is really written around Algebra 2, and
yep.
Our kiddos don't have access to Algebra 2 till they're juniors. So we'll continue to work on it. It's going to be a very hot topic of conversation as we move forward.
And there's no way to get around, they have to pass
right.
This test.
That was part of the new law to be able to test earlier, but what you're saying is that it may not benefit us because of the schedule that most of our students are on related to math and what year they take what.
But we also believe as a system that our students are better prepared to go into Algebra 2 as a result of statistics. Mm-hmm. And so we did have students who had taken Algebra 2 and took the assessment as sophomores that passed. And so we're just going to continue to watch it.
And they're on record as passed.
Yes.
That counts now.
Yes,
and
they've already met the standard. Mm-hmm.
Even though they took it voluntarily early,
yeah.
Now that it's
voluntold, maybe.
Yeah.
We nudged them. We wanted to encourage them because the more opportunities they have to take it, the better students are. So
they took it not knowing that it was going to count, and now the law's changed in the count.
Yeah.
That's a bonus.
Yeah.
So the interim Smarter Balanced Assessments, is that for all grades, or are you thinking mostly elementary?
It's for all grades. It's available for all grades. We're going to continue. We have grade levels that have really taken it on, and certainly there are proponents at each of the grade levels at elementary that really believe in it and have seen some phenomenal results as they've used those. Their kids have indicated a higher pass rate. And so it's a matter of continuing to work with that group and moving that forward, helping teachers to feel supported, doing some intentional professional development. And they're also using some of them at middle school. So again, it's to create the culture. The one challenge with the interims is that they're not computer adaptive like the Smarter Balanced is. And so that's a little bit of a challenge because a good test is. And so, but they tell us, Smarter Balance tells us that that's coming. I actually thought it was coming last year, so hopefully it'll be coming soon. They have made tremendous progress with the work that they've done with the assessments, and so I'm anticipating that we'll see some adaptive tests.
So since the Smarter Balanced Assessment is a state requirement, does the state pay for any of the scoring of that, or is that
of the interims?
Well, that was my question: is
the ones that are required, I'm wondering if the state picks up more, but the interim would have to come from the district.
The interim, anything that would require hand score, that's our cost. But the power in hand scoring, I've been doing this for a long time to know that real growth occurs in teaching and in learning when you can hand score assessments, because you all get together and have the same conversation. that when we submit the tests, well, I mean, now they're scored so quickly in comparison to the olden days when we were doing paper pencil. So, and the state assumes that cost.
So will the classroom teachers be scoring the interim assessment?
Yes.
Okay.
But we'll continue to work with folks on that. It's just that's just a goal that we have, one that we're going to continue to explore.
And it's not, most of the test is computer graded.
Yes.
There's only a small portion of each interim that's actually hand graded.
Okay.
The other correction, I just want to, it starts in grade 3. We do not have smarter balance for K1 or 2, so.
Right.
Yeah.
So when you say all grades, I just want to
make sure. No, I meant all the grades.
Yeah. All grades starting
in just in case somebody was listening.
Yeah, no,
yeah,
that's a
that's
fair
good.
Point.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I just want to point out that.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's overwhelming, isn't it?
Lots going on.
Thank you.
It changes quite a bit.
Yes. Okay. Next, we will be looking at changes to three different policies. Superintendent Maxwell.
Yep.
The first one is policy 2022.
Actually, property purchase.
Oh, I'm sorry. Property purchase, my bad. Yeah, the next item is property purchase.
I'm going to pull up the map first, so just to orientate folks to where this is at, SR 27 is right here where the arrow runs. Mm-hmm. Right here is, I think this is a seed plant. This
for
is
lentil,
Albion, Pullman Albion Road, right here.
Pulses.
So it's about 100 yards off of SR 27 and borders Albion. We have an opportunity to purchase 5 acres, which is outlined in this rectangle. This will be the 5 acres that we are proposing to purchase for a future site for transportation center, possibly maintenance. We've been looking, as you know, for 2 years for a piece of property. This is zoned light industrial. It's within the Pullman city limits. So we could have a transportation site on here. This is part of an 8.8 acres. This dotted line is the other piece, which in the purchase agreement, if we follow through with the 5 acres, we would have first right of refusal on the remaining property. With that, we would have 2 points to the property for access from Albion Road. So tentatively, there would be one on the east side and one on the west. Utilities are on the other side of the road. We would be responsible for pulling utilities to the site. This is probably the best piece of property that we have been able to locate in 2 years at, I would say, a very good cost. So,
And as opposed to the one piece we were looking at, it's not.
I'm sure it's you, Diane. You started it.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
So again, the price for the piece of property of 5 acres would be $335,000. Again, our current site is woefully inadequate, and we just cannot remain to operate out of there efficiently or effectively. We also use a current site as a student transportation.
And it's not safe.
Our transfer station, excuse me, transfer station. It just, it's it's not a good situation. So we definitely need to, so the recommendation I'm proposing for you to consider would be to purchase that piece of property.
So you think we could combine the maintenance as well as transportation on this property?
It's just a thought in the future if we ever wanted to go that way. I'm not saying that that's what it would be, but we would have space enough to do that if we needed to. Or for something else that we may not think about we need now, 5 acres would give us some reasonable room.
So then we could potentially sell those two sites to cover, help abate the cost some?
Possibly. I would definitely say the current transportation site would be one that we would, I would suggest that we would put up for sale.
Yeah.
I like the proposal for three reasons. One, location, and two is the fact that there's no previous use, which has to do with hazardous waste mitigation and so on, such as the one site we were looking at where it might have required environmental fund abatement. And the third is that we have this still the right of first refusal.
Correct.
Should we decide to combine even more that, such as possibility of a district headquarters if we don't move on improvements at Pioneer Center and so on.
Right. It just gives us some great flexibility in the future. One of the things that we're running into constantly is finding anything close to the city limits zoned correctly at a reasonable price is almost impossible. Now, could we find something probably out in Whitman County? Maybe. But then again, if it's not near water, we would no way be able to drill a well. I mean, we would have to pull utilities a ridiculous amount of distance. It just doesn't make sense. And I strongly believe if we're preparing for the future that two other pieces of property that we're looking at have already been picked up within this year, south of town. I would strongly advocate that we do something and soon.
Part of what I was suggesting about location is the fact that there's new sewer that's down the Albion Road and then upgraded all the way down the highway.
Now, utilities are across the street, so we would have to incur the cost.
We'll have the cost of that.
Bringing them across, but the other piece that we were looking at, there was another piece of property in this general area. It was a quarter mile to bring the utilities in. And the cost of that was astronomical.
Oh, that's crazy.
Yep.
So they would enter, I mean, the buses would come from to the Albion Road and then go on to 270? Is that how the traffic would flow then?
It depends how we would take a look at that. But they would go up 27 and then turn onto Albion, and then there would be two easements in and out onto Albion Road, which would give us a lot of flexibility.
Yeah, okay.
Is there any advantage to maybe asking for an easement to 270, or would that be too complicated?
The property doesn't go all that way.
No, it doesn't go all the way down to 27?
No. The seed plant
blocks it.
Pull the map up again. I thought we were on the backside of that seed plant. Or does seed plant actually own that out into the...
It is. Sorry, let me pull this up.
There it is.
Now that it does show this, but I believe, and I could be wrong, I'm not sure who owns this piece of property.
There's also quite an elevation difference from the ground and the highway.
Oh, okay.
I can check into that. I don't believe it's the same property owner.
It's way safer to enter at a controlled intersection anyway. I don't think that's a really...
I think so, too.
I
get emergency access, maybe, but really, if you've got two ways in and out of that site, that's pretty good.
I believe in the future this will probably be a controlled intersection.
Must be.
Inevitably.
Yeah, absolutely.
which the other reason we were looking at a site, of course, over on this side, the one thing is pulling onto a major highway.
Yeah, it's a little iffy.
It's something, you know, unless you have a light. But that's something I could also ask is who's here. But right now we would have the property agreement calls for this piece to have two access points.
Yeah.
And tentatively they would be drawn in here.
The property to the south of that has planned for access onto 27, but never received DOT approval for that access. And the DOT is into limiting access onto 27. So there might be a possibility in the future of a light there with this increased traffic and the fact that to the west is in the annexation plan for the city all the way to where Bogle-Brayton Road meets Albion Road. That's part of that is what is going to be expanded Copper Basin.
So, any other questions on the?
I just know we have to do something, especially for the safety of our students in the transferring. I mean, it's pretty interesting up where they're doing it. So
I would say for the welfare of the employees at that site, too.
Yeah.
It's a win-win for everybody.
Yes. Yes.
Tammy's cheering us on.
Yes.
Well, currently, we don't have enough parking spaces for all our employees to park. We have some to park over at the fire station, and then across the road, and we're double parking there. And then when somebody comes to get a van, then that's one more vehicle. And
It's inadequate.
It's just not. We've
for kids, staff, and buses.
Even with the new bathroom, it's still inadequate. Oh, geez, always something.
All right, now policy 2022 electronic resources.
Yeah, so part of our ongoing policy and procedures review, I'd like to submit for your consideration 2022 electronic resources. So this policy has been reviewed to align with the WASDA sample policy. It creates a district focus on electronic resources for the purpose of enhancing and supporting teaching and learning. Again, it's some pretty minor changes. I'll pull those up here. Hold on. So, of course, I'm sure you can all read that. But again, the electronic resources, it talks about creating and making sure that we have systems in place. Of course, internet safety is one of our main goals to make sure. Also making sure that we provide appropriate staff development is the other piece that we need to pay attention to. Luckily, our staff are very well trained in our electronic resources. And then a couple of the legal references have also been updated and cross-reference policies.
I thought it was strange the use of the word strong, create strong electronic resources.
Yeah.
Just like creating a strong password.
Rather than weak.
Yeah.
Weak electronic resources, so yeah.
Yeah, I'm just not sure that that's a measurable.
I can definitely take out the word strong, so I don't think that would change the WASDA's, or hurt WASDA's feelings.
Either. Yeah. Does it mean something to you?
No, I think it's just a filler, personally.
Okay.
But any questions?
Nope.
Okay.
All right, 2024, online learning.
Yes. Let's see if I can do it without. So again, this policy was updated to align with WASDA. Minor revisions include referencing the online courses and programs are critical to the 21st century and provide students with unique opportunities to become self-disciplined learners. The really common sense type thing is one of them more as a philosophy statement that was added, but in keeping up to date on our policies and procedures. So again,
I would like to remove the word tremendous. It has no place in a policy.
It's strong and tremendous.
I don't know if this is reflective of the new WASDA.
I think it's the new person that was hired to review.
Well,
superlative.
Well, she just started on the 12th of.
Yeah.
Or 14th.
I mean, she's brand new, so I don't know. Yeah. But that's.
So you can see this one's very minor. It's really just adding a philosophy statement and
like a justification
for online learning. So yeah. trying to keep up to date and not fall years behind in our policies and procedures. I don't think I would hurt WASDA's feelings by taking the word tremendous out.
Okay. We have discussed. Now I'm blanking on the name for it, but when students take online courses, they're generally in like 11th and 12th grade and can demonstrate that they are able to work independently, right?
For the most part, correct.
Okay.
We do have
the ALE.
Freshmen and sophomores that do some online learning, but primarily it's designed for 11th and 12th graders.
Okay. And this doesn't affect homeschooling?
No.
Okay.
I wonder if maybe in the procedure or something that intent would maybe be expressed of who, because it's not that we're encouraging every student to study core subjects online.
No,
I don't know.
Tremendously recommend against
it.
Yeah, and I think it's just one of these where it's more, this one's, obviously not a priority, but it is one that online learning is becoming more and more accessible, and I think they're trying to keep up with what the future may hold. Mm-hmm. So, and we do currently have online options.
Okay.
Good questions.
3246. Again.
Find out what the word is for this one.
Yes. Restraint, isolation, and other uses of reasonable force.
Correct. So let me pull that up.
Is it my imagination, or do we look at this?
You recently
frequently?
Looked at this, yes. And
okay.
It changes every legislative session. So,
all right.
Of course it does.
This policy, you've seen it before at least 4 times.
Okay.
So this policy
was in March.
Yeah,
so of this year, reacting to last year's legislation.
So they've changed again. So the title of the policy has been updated to match the procedures. The policy makes reference to restraint and isolation, in addition to really what these are, again, describing what is reasonable or acceptable use and limits on discipline or punishment. So let me get out of here, and I will actually pull it up for you. And again, this one we do not have a lot of opportunity to change anything because this is almost verbatim law. So if the word tremendous is in here, we don't have a whole lot of flexibility. So I'll just give you a highlight ahead of time.
Now, did you say the title is changed?
The title was different from what we had on our procedure, so it was just a correction
we
found. So,
because it's underlined here, so I wasn't sure if that was meant to indicate.
It was something we noticed when we were updating. So
the procedure says restraint devices.
Correct.
And we're not using zip ties anymore.
Remember, this is the policy.
Okay.
The procedure has a whole list of descriptions of restraint devices.
Okay, but what is the name of this policy? Is it in fact restraint, isolation, and other force?
Correct.
Okay, so that would need to say that on the title, right?
Yeah, we need to take a look at that and okay. see why it didn't come up. So I will check on the title.
Shouldn't they align?
Yeah, it's puzzling.
We'll check. Take a look at okay. the title to make sure it's correct.
It seems like we should have the procedure title aligned.
Yes.
Yes.
They should. Whatever it is, they should be the same.
So we will make sure that we get that corrected.
Thank you.
But again, this one is just imminent likelihood of serious harm, RCW. Really, there's not a whole lot you can change in this one. So, and my guess is it will change again.
Yeah.
So we might get to go a year. And that is all I have for you this evening.
All right. The packet contains several informational items, including the procedures that accompany these policies, and a procedure for language access plan. We have no executive or closed session this evening.
Oh, still my heart.
And I know. And so with that,
I will move that we adjourn.
Second.
Oh, it's been moved and seconded that we adjourn this meeting. Is there any discussion?
No discussion on this motion.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay.